I'm Kenneth Welsh. Stay tuned for more Northern Mysteries. The terrain is harsh in the Northwest Territories, part of which is now known as Nunavut. While summer temperatures bring forth spring-like meadows, winter conditions turn the land into an icy hell, with endless hours of darkness lasting for months and blizzards blowing in from the Arctic. Temperatures can drop to minus 40 degrees centigrade. 75 years ago, this tundra was the scene of one of the most incredible manhunts in Canadian history. The hunt for the mad trapper of Rat River. It was February 17th, 1932, at Eagle River, Northwest Territories, and RCMP officers found themselves in the midst of gunfire meant to bring down trapper Albert Johnson. Two charges had been brought against Johnson, murder and attempted murder. Both charges involved officers of the Royal Canadian Mounted Police. Johnson was clever and stubborn. For more than a month now, he'd been able to elude search parties chasing him in temperatures close to minus 50 degrees Celsius. But today was the day his luck had run out. He was hit with a bullet as he attempted to run away, and he fell face down to the ground. Officers Eames and May were well familiar with his tricks and thought this might just be another one. As they stood over him, they reflected on the events leading up to his death. This was the end of one of the most incredible manhunts in Canadian history. But as the great chase ended, a question arose. Who was Albert Johnson, the mad trapper of Rat River? In the early 1930s, the Northwest Territories and the Yukon were under the jurisdiction of the Royal Canadian Mounted Police. This was a huge area, almost desert-like, where prospectors thought they were above the law, and hunting was often synonymous with poaching.
In the summer of 1931, a man appeared around the Arctic River settlement. He arrived on a raft of three logs, and he was seen by some Native Americans in the area. He was described as very silent, very strange. He didn't seem to want to associate with any human beings. He told people he wanted to be left alone. The RCMP came to know about him because in that time, during the Depression, there was a lot of men going up into the north to try to be miners or prospectors. And a lot of them arrived without the proper equipment or skills. So the RCMP wanted to make sure that every new arrival in the area checked in with the detachment so that they knew who was there, if they had the proper equipment, and if they could survive in the bush.
In the summer of 1931, RCMP officer Edgar Millen stopped at Fort McPherson General Store to buy some food supplies. He noticed that a foreigner was asking about the best spots for trapping. The man, who spoke with a slight Scandinavian accent, said that his name was Albert Johnson, and he planned to move up north near Rat River. Constable Millen said that a license was required for trapping in these territories, but Johnson pretended that he hadn't heard.
We don't really hear much more about Albert Johnson until Christmas of that year, when some of the trappers in the area found that some of their traps had been messed with, you know, flung on trees, the baits had been pulled out and so forth. And given that hunting was and trapping was how people fed their families, this was a pretty big issue when somebody messes with your traps, because it was sort of this unwritten rule, you know, you leave people's traps alone. And they suspected that it was Albert Johnson.
That was when Millen, who had a vague recollection of his first meeting with Johnson, decided to send officers Alfred King and Joseph Bernard to investigate. Using dog sleds to make the journey, the Mounties took 2 days to cross the 40 kilometers from Arctic Red River to Johnson's cabin. The hermit refused to open his door to the officers.
They knocked, they stayed outside his door for an hour, and this is in minus 40 temperature on day after Christmas. Usually in the Arctic, when a stranger shows up to your cabin, you let them in, you extend hospitality. It was very strange that Johnson didn't open the door to the constable. The constable had to return to Arctic River, obtain a warrant, and return back to the cabin to see Johnson.
On December 31st, 1931, officers King and Bernard, accompanied by Mounties Lazarus Citiculus and Robert McDowell, returned to Johnson's cabin to question him. But Johnson still wanted nothing to do with them and greeted them with gunfire. They shot back and Officer King got hit in the shoulder. He eventually made his way to cover. Given the seriousness of the situation, the group decided to give up the attack on Johnson and return to Aklavik. This time, Johnson was charged with attempted murder. On January 9th, a group of men headed back to Johnson's cabin, determined to capture him and to make him pay for his acts.
He's been called the Mad Trapper. People have said he's demented. But the evidence from the constables at the time in the reports, they thought he was very clever, very smart, very well adapted, and did not see any signs of madness, as it were.
This time, the men were prepared for a long, drawn-out battle with plenty of ammunition and 8 kilograms of dynamite. Much to their surprise, the trapper was waiting for the attack and opened fire on them. The gunplay continued for several hours. Losing hope, Eames instructed his men to toss dynamite onto Johnson's cabin, but the air temperature was so cold that most of the sticks of dynamite did not explode. After several attempts, they finally succeeded in blowing the roof off the cabin, but the trapper still refused to give himself up.
After about 15 hours, and I mean, his cabin was completely, like, the wall had caved in and everything. I mean, everybody else would have probably given up at that point, but not him. And at that point, the Mounties said, okay, well, we're running out of food. We have nothing left to feed the dogs. It's cold, and this is getting dangerous. We need to leave and regroup. So they went back and regrouped.
In the meantime, knowing that his life was in peril, Johnson fled by foot, heading northwest, in the hopes that he could cross the Alaskan border. At this time of year, with the lay of the land and the high winds, the air temperature could easily drop to minus 80 degrees Celsius. What could Johnson possibly have to hide from the police that would drive him to live in such unbearable conditions?
There's theories abound about who this man was. Some are very far-flung. Some people think he was a Russian spy. Others think he was a Chicago gangster who was on the run for killing a journalist in Chicago. Other people think he was a bank robber from North Dakota. But there's no definitive evidence of who this man was. The strongest possibility seems to indicate that he was probably Arthur Nelson, who was a man that was in Dease Lake area in BC, and also in the Yukon around the area Johnson frequented, by the name of Arthur Nelson. And they think they may have been the same person, but even that, there's no conclusive evidence. As best as can be pieced together from the evidence, it seems that this was a loner, a man who, for whatever reason, went up north to be alone, away from civilization. And through circumstances that weren't of his making, he came into contact with the law. And rather than face his interrogators and face questioning, he chose to fight back. There's various theories about why he did what he did. Some people have surmised that he had a criminal past, either in the States or elsewhere, and was evading the law for a crime that he had committed previously, but that has never been proven. Some members of the RCMP at the time did get the feeling that Johnson was trying to hide something, or had the feeling that Johnson thought the RCMP knew something about him, which in reality the RCMP didn't. But from his actions, it seemed that Johnson himself thought the police knew something about his past and was trying to avoid them.
On February 3rd, 1932, after facing setbacks and humiliation for close to 45 days, Eames's men finally sensed that they were closing in.
The Inspector Eames, who ran the manhunt, realized he needed to do something that was very different because their traditional policing techniques were obviously not working on catching the mad trapper. And the manhunt was generating headlines, newspaper headlines, you know, as far as New York and London. So I'm sure he quite felt the pressure as well. And he figured, well, bring in an airplane. Maybe that'll help. Because they were having trouble keeping their men on the ground supplied and also finding the tracks.
The idea was so unusual at the time that Eames had to get authorization from the National Department of Justice. On February 5th, Wap May, a bush pilot who had fought in World War I, joined the search team and made a world of difference. Johnson's attempts to flee were coming to an end.
He'd been away from his cabin for, you know, about a month at that point. So, and he wasn't eating well because he couldn't shoot his rifle, because as soon as you shoot anything, people will be able to figure out where you are, they'll be able to locate you. So he was just sort of snaring small animals that he was able to eat very quickly, and wasn't building big fires because the smoke from the fires would also give away his location. So he was very savvy, very, very wilderness savvy.
On February 17th, Wap May spotted Johnson near East River. Johnson was on the lookout for the federal agents. Trappers and soldiers joined Eames's men. Johnson was caught in a snare and was prepared for anything. In the midst of the gunfire, Johnson shot Millen in the head, killing him. In a fit of panic, the fugitive left his cover. He'd only gotten a few meters when a bullet hit him in the spine. Johnson fell down, motionless. What drove this foul-tempered loner to become a murderer? What justified Albert Johnson's crazy behavior? A real northern mystery.
Who was Albert Johnson? Entire novels have been written on this historical mystery. This manhunt also marked a new era in crime fighting. It was the first time that the Royal Canadian Mounted Police used a plane to track a fugitive, and the first time that shortwave radios were used to coordinate ground movements. With the case of the mad trapper of Rat River, the RCMP had to adapt to new technologies, which would revolutionize criminal justice in the 20th century.
While most victims of possession are controlled against their will, other people voluntarily call upon the forces of evil and look to the devil for guidance. It's said that some will do anything to please the diabolical masters, even the unthinkable.
In this makeshift chapel in Victoria, BC, a 6-year-old girl is about to be the center of a terrifying ritual, despite her will. The child faces a man she doesn't know. A group of men and women enter. They murmur a chorus of unintelligible litanies. Without looking at the terrified child, they form a semicircle. They all wear black, except for one young woman. The heart of the young girl is now racing with fear. The man in the background signals, and the strange ceremony begins.
everyone is perfectly familiar with the sequence and outcome of the macabre ritual. Someone takes the girl in their arms and lays her on the altar. The adults hold her down. From the corner of her eye, she sees the man approaching her. One of the disciples gives him the chalice. The others force the girl to keep her mouth open. She's terrified. The girl hears a voice talking to her. "Everything's all right, Michelle. At the count of three, open your eyes. One, two, three." It will take Michelle Smith a long time to regain her composure, because now, Michelle remembers. Apparently, when Michelle Smith was 5 years old, her mother gave her to a satanic cult where she was abused and forced to take part in demonic sacrifices. That's what she discovered at age 27 when she went to see Dr. Pasder, a psychologist in Victoria. Up until then, she had no memory of these events, but had serious emotional problems. For the doctor, it was clear that his patient's problems stemmed from her childhood, and he decided to use regressive hypnosis to unlock her memory.
Every time she entered into a new area of working, everything that she'd said before was totally consistent. It had a ring of truth to it that I said, you know, this is not accountable from anything in the literature except from the fact that she'd been through that experience. There's no other way I can explain it.
The abuse her parents took part in allegedly lasted a number of years. In 1980, after 4 years of therapy, Michelle wrote about her experience in a book entitled Michelle Remembers. The bestseller triggered a wave of charges. All over the continent, people came forward to say they too had been the victims of devil worshippers.
There's not really any recruiting. In my case, it was the workers at the daycare center who got me into it. They got me involved in it without my family's knowledge.
In Satanism as well as in Luferianism, the basic philosophy is the same. It goes back to medieval times. They meet in small covens, never more than 13 to a coven. As we all know, the number 13 is associated with superstition. But for the most part, especially Satanism, it's a religion of solitary practitioners. That's why it's hard to know how many there are, because these are people who engage in it alone at home. It's a quest for knowledge, a quest for power. As I often repeat in my lectures, it's an illusion. After all, it's hardly something you'd put on your resume.
The book Michelle Remembers sparked an obsession with satanic ritual abuse. For years, the apparent existence of satanic cults would be considered a hidden danger. Rumors spread that these devil worshippers had infiltrated schools, multinational corporations, and government agencies. They were also said to be linked with drug trafficking and the child trade.
I think we shouldn't lose sight of the fact that these things have to do with religion. These are pagan religions, a return to paganism. In some cases, unfortunately, they acted out, even going as far as cannibalism. This involves killing, followed by a ritual, a kind of parody of the mass, the eating of human flesh and drinking of human blood. But keep in mind, these are cases of people who want to get more power. It's about seeking Lucifer's power. I remember one follower from the time I was a priestess who dreamed of giving birth to the Antichrist. That was her dream. Giving birth to the Antichrist was her goal in life. But why? Because it was a power trip, an ego trip, because we're all nothing more than a number. And so she was fed up with being just a number. She wanted to be someone. And she wanted to be nothing less than the mother of the Antichrist.
The fear whipped up by sensational media and certain religious groups became so strong that the FBI eventually became involved. the investigation was assigned to Agent Kenneth Lanning, a specialist in child abuse cases.
What I discovered when I started to talk to the scholars and the people who've studied is these kinds of panics and scares have come and gone and ebbed and flowed all down through history.
Lanning spent months tracking all the clues, reviewing all the accusations and allegations. No one before him had ever taken such a deep interest in the activities of so-called satanic cults.
Many of these cases, what these people are alleging, are multiple murders, blood, and, you know, body fluids, and children being molested and photographed, the kinds of stuff that is not so easy to get rid of. A good crime scene team could go in there and still find evidence of the murders. And in all the cases that I was involved in, when the police did those kinds of things, they still could not find this corroborative evidence.
Lanning's report contradicted everything the media had been claiming. It states he found no evidence of child abuse or murder by satanic cults in North America, and no links to drug trafficking and the child trade either. Although some crimes look like the devil's work, they're perpetrated by eccentric loners. But then how do you explain the horror stories told by Michelle Smith and the throngs of other victims?
Traditionally, hypnosis has always been linked to memory. Popular belief would have it that if you hypnotize someone, that person immediately unlocks a databank of past memories, which wouldn't be accessible without hypnosis. From the very moment I became interested in the idea of hypnosis and memories, we realized that among all the methods used, hypnosis was probably the worst when someone wants to recall something.
As evidence, the investigation found that many of the places described never existed, not to mention that many of the people named in the stories were not where their accusers claimed they had been. In light of these revelations, what is the true face of Satan and his disciples?
Americans seem to be really drawn to cases where there is a clear-cut line between good and evil. That's the great appeal, that the offender is as evil as possible. And of course, one thing that clearly puts you in this category is you're a Satanist. So you worship the devil. That puts you right at the top of the crowd.
Oddly enough, the devil actually plays a secondary role in the religion of devil worshippers. To them, Satanism is above all a way of life, a philosophy based on the absence of taboos and morality, a doctrine that focuses on pleasure. Is this the same doctrine that was preached by Charles Manson 30 years ago when he declared during his trial, "In my mind's eye, my thoughts light fires in your cities"?
Fantastic encounters, enigmatic disappearances, strange truths, and fabulous legends. Maybe someone can finally reveal the truth behind these extraordinary mysteries. And maybe that someone is you. I'm Kenneth Welsh. Don't miss these Northern Mysteries.
The others, The Sixth Sense, Poltergeist, Amityville Horror, all of these movies are terrifying ghost stories. One of the reasons that they were such huge hits at the box office is that many of us like to be scared, at least in the comfort of a movie theater. We would no doubt feel differently if these visitors from beyond showed up in our schools. Taking their time, the two men finished setting up the room. The janitor and his assistant lined up 60 or so chairs. A morning of instruction, including a slideshow, was on the program for the next day. One final detail was left. The men lowered the blinds and locked them into position. Everything was perfect. The employees left the room, taking care to close the door behind them. Then they closed the door to the hallway. The building was empty once again. But was it really? The slightest creak, the tiniest noise echoes through the empty rooms. Bit by bit, shadows overtake the still school. An icy chill creeps over the school. On the second floor, a ruckus begins in the projection room, dispelling the quiet. Within the space of a few minutes, a mysterious force has transformed the room into a battleground. Built in 1904, McKay Avenue School now serves as Edmonton Public Schools Archives and Museum. The current building stands in the exact same spot where in 1881, the first public school was built in the school district of Edmonton of the Northwest Territories.
The history of the McKay School consists of the school being the first brick school in the city of Edmonton, Alberta, and also housed the first legislative assembly for Alberta. This is back in the early 20th century.
Then by 1912, the population of Edmonton had really grown, and they needed to double the size of this school. So they put the addition on in 1912, and that's where you and I are standing right now, just as grand and just as glorious.
In its heyday back in 1916, the school had 456 students. After that, the number of students enrolled continued to drop. In 1983, the school closed due to a lack of students. Some of the school's former students have gone on to become famous in entertainment, business, and politics, such as actor Leslie Nielsen, Supreme Court Judge Ronald Martland, and Clarence Campbell, former president of the National Hockey League. Although it has changed functions over the years, McKay School has always been the scene of bizarre and inexplicable events. It is said that the school is haunted. Over and over again, boilers have been mysteriously turned on or off. Locked doors have been found unlocked, and objects have been moved about in the school. But who or what has been responsible for these strange phenomena?
Many, many workers in Edmonton were involved in the reconstruction. One of them was apparently a man named Peter. He was a laborer during construction of the 1912 addition, and apparently he fell to his death from the third floor here. And his spirit has never left Mackay Avenue School. It's here still.
Is the school haunted by the ghost of Peter, who died when he fell off the roof on January 3rd, 1912? The manifestations at the Mackay Museum are so well known that employees absolutely refuse to remain in the building alone. Except, perhaps, Ron Talati.
Well, I've been working here at Mackay Avenue School, it'll be 21 years this October. And there's been a fair amount of paranormal experiences that I've had happen here.
For more than 20 years now, Ron Halady has been taking care of the museum's collections and grounds. No one knows the Mackay Museum better than he does. No one, that is, other than the building's invisible inhabitants. Many years ago, after having experienced several unusual incidents, Ron brought a Ouija board to work. He was able to establish contact with one of the ghosts haunting the museum, a man named Peter.
I brought the Ouija board in, and that's how I discovered that the main spirit here, his name's Peter. He told me at that time, through the Ouija board, that he was a laborer working on the addition in 1912, and he fell off and perished. And he has supposedly three daughters during his lifetime, and one daughter is still alive in California, but he couldn't give me a last name. I figured that was probably with him being a laborer, and at that time in history, he was not that literate, so he could only, you know, spell his first name.
According to rumors, a half dozen spirits roam the building's hallways. That doesn't come as any surprise to Ron, who's been the janitor so long that he's seen a lot over the years.
Yes.
But Peter was the only spirit Ron found.
Peter.
Yes, I think Peter is not the only spirit here, and I have confirmed that through the Ouija board at Mackay Avenue here, and I brought psychics in here, and they've confirmed that there's more than one spirit besides Peter. So there's quite a few.
Over the years, psychics, ghostbusters, and thrill seekers alike have visited Mackay Avenue School. Many have walked away with a memory of a strange occurrence. In the early 1990s, Barbara Smith, author of several books on ghosts, witnessed a bizarre incident firsthand.
Peter's whereabouts has been documented by people. Now, the one time that I actually brought a group of psychics in here, Peter would not come forward at all. But many, many other spirits came through. One I remember distinctly, this was the early 1990s, and we were in a small room downstairs, and the woman psychic said to me, "Oh, my jaw hurts in this room." And Ron, who has worked here for many years, said that that was because that used to be the dentist's office in the school. So that was rather interesting, but I thought equally interesting that Peter would not show himself. And yet Peter is very forthcoming with Ron, who is almost, they're almost on a friendly co-worker sort of a basis.
In October 2004, the Spectral Investigators Group of Alberta conducted a large experiment consisting of volunteers with no prior knowledge of any activities in the school other than the fact that it was haunted.
Investigators, who prefer to take a scientific approach to paranormal phenomena, chose a group of 30 individuals and gave them a questionnaire. They then asked the participants to walk around the building in small groups of five or six.
Each individual would write down their feelings and go through 20 plus locations without any knowledge of particular locations where activities are.
When the experiment was over, SIGA investigators found that an unusually high number of participants had reported feeling uncomfortable in several rooms.
70% of the volunteers picked out the specific locations of where the haunting activities were located.
Although such statistics may have been expected for participants already aware of the manifestations, there is no accounting for the same high statistics among participants who had no prior knowledge of the hauntings. Researchers found that most participants tended to experience the uncomfortable feeling in the same rooms. The study led by the SIGA group only served to reinforce the belief or the certainty that McKay School was haunted.
There are many spirits here at McKay Avenue. They're friendly and they're comfortable, so they're not going to leave.
As far as Ron Hiladi is concerned, these invisible inhabitants are part of his everyday life. The technician even has a certain affinity for these visitors from beyond the grave, particularly Peter.
Peter, during the 1912 edition, he fell off the roof and he supposedly died on January 3rd. Our 1881 schoolhouse, which is located on the southwest part of our lot here, it opened on January 3rd, 1882. And I was born on January 3rd.
Talk about a bizarre coincidence. Chances are 1 in 48 million, according to statistics. Is that proof?
There's no way to convince a skeptic that a haunting is real. And conversely, I think there's no way to talk someone who believes in a haunting out of it. And I think that that's as it should be. To my mind, this is just a very beautiful old building, and spirits definitely remain here for me. I like the fact that Peter's here. I think Peter's here while we're doing this interview, and that brings me great comfort on a number of levels.
Investigating cases like the one at the school on McKay Avenue means delving into the past. The search for the origin of these apparitions can lead to the discovery of historical details that were previously unknown, and can sometimes help us to distinguish between fact and fantasy, if we do our research properly. If we believe what's been written, Canada has hundreds of public places that are haunted, like the Royal Museum in Toronto, the Fort Garry Hotel in Winnipeg, and the Vogue Theatre in Vancouver. The Vogue Theatre was filled to capacity that night. The critics all agreed. Unforgettable, the music of Nat Cole was a runaway hit. Shane McPherson, who was playing the legendary crooner Mel Torme, came on stage and began to perform with uncanny ease. Each number he did was backed by the bewitching sounds of the orchestra. The actor focused on his choreography, trying to make his character come alive for the audience. Shortly after McPherson began his performance, a stranger appeared in the wings. The dancer was taken by surprise at the sight. No one except technicians and actors were allowed backstage. McPherson watched the stranger for a few seconds. And suddenly, the man disappeared before his very eyes. The actor was so shaken that he stopped his dance solo. Backstage, his fellow actors were surprised. When McPherson told them about the apparition, no one else seemed to have noticed this unusual person. The actor was apparently the only one who had seen the ghost, that night at least. In 1940, the Riefel family began building a theater on Granville Street in Vancouver. It was hoped that the Vogue Theater would welcome the best theatrical groups in the country. But barely 1 year after construction had begun, the building was sold and used as a cinema. In the dark hours of the Second World War, the Vogue quickly became the most popular cinema in Vancouver.
It was one of the top three theaters in Vancouver in its day, in 1941. It was known because it had air conditioning, it had the best sound equipment of any theater in Vancouver. And the Art Deco design really appealed to the in crowd of that day.
The Vogue Theater changed hands and artistic direction a few times during 1940 and 1991, when it finally returned to its initial role as a popular theater. As soon as the theater reopened, employees began to complain of unusual incidents. There were reports of footsteps in empty hallways and doors opening and closing on their own. One time, posters that an employee had carefully stored in a locked cupboard were found the next morning spread out on the floor. Some employees even claimed to have seen apparitions.
When I started at the Vogue, I didn't know it was haunted, but sometime within my first couple of months, I was downstairs one night locking up the carpentry room. And as I put some tools away into a tool chest, I got that feeling that you get when you know somebody's right behind you. And I turned around, and as I did, what I call a three-dimensional shadow seemed to glide by the door to the room. I walked out into the hall. I was alone in the theater. I looked left, I looked right, I saw nothing, and I closed up and got out as fast as I could.
Since 1991, there seemed to be more and more mysterious apparitions at the Vogue Theater. Visitors, actors, and technicians all claim to have seen what seems to be the same person, a man in his 30s with short black hair, dressed in a faded suit.
There's a fair amount of evidence to suggest it's the same ghost. A couple of the sightings which had no opportunity to corroborate each other's stories have seen and described the same individual. In particular, a group of us were upstairs one night in the projection booth. And as we walked in, one of the women in the group stopped, backed out of the projection booth, wouldn't talk to anybody about it until a few days later when she said she'd seen a man, youngish, maybe sort of early 30s, with dark hair, in light clothing, sitting in one of the chairs. And he'd turned and he'd scowled at her. She said she got a real sense of menace off of him.
Dave was downstairs closing up after a matinee. This was happened just shortly, the day after, actually, the McPherson incident where he saw the ghost on the stage. And Dave was closing up and was looking up toward the projection booth when he saw a man with short cropped hair, what they used to call in the 50s crew cuts, and heavy eyebrows, standing there by the projection booth. Dave took it in, the figure faded and disappeared.
We've had psychics and mediums and paranormal investigators in and out of here over at least the last decade. Some claim there's more than one presence. The main one seems to be this fellow who I think we all suspect is probably a former theater employee, because he shows up in the working areas, on the stage, in the hallway down below, which is so haunted that we call it the Ghost Highway.
According to popular belief, ghostly apparitions are usually the spirits of people who have died at the site and have come back to haunt it.
There's no record of anyone being killed. There's no record even of serious injury. I've asked former managers, and they can't recall anything. But, you know, the theater was built in 1941. It was run primarily as a movie house. You don't know what happened during the building. We don't have any, you know, there was a fairly high staff turnover at the Vogue.
Well, there has been some conjecture that it was a projectionist, but for whatever reason, if there's anything goes wrong in a cinema, like ghosts appearing, it's always the projectionist. So the point is, nobody knows for sure. Oh, there is also another rumor that it may be an individual that lived here prior to them building the Vogue in 1941. The question is really open. Modern people that now that are interested in ghosts are hanging out in cemeteries. The truth is, guys, you're not going to find a lot of ghosts in cemeteries. It's so boring in cemeteries. Would you like to sit around cemeteries all the time? No. You want to go someplace where there's some action. That's why you find so much action in theaters and in pubs particularly.
When they're empty, public places can make us feel uncomfortable with their large empty stages, unoccupied seats, and hallways trailing off into the shadows. In such an atmosphere, it is natural for our senses to be heightened. The echo of a distant conversation or a toilet flushing could be misinterpreted as a supernatural occurrence. But for the employees of the Vogue Theater, or the janitor of the school in K Avenue, that doesn't explain everything. The study of spiritual apparitions goes far beyond a simple excursion into the realm of the paranormal. Legends have something to teach us, but our past and our future, even the one beyond the grave. When the unknown shakes a person's confidence, their imagination can run wild. But true mysteries may be doorways to the fantastic realm of knowledge.
In our rationalized and predictable world, nothing fascinates and unsettles us more than the feeling of mystery that comes over us when we face the unknown.
In 1996, one family finds itself at the heart of an unbelievable murder story. But what can be done when the victims are long dead and their assailant is but a shadow? In 1984, acting on revelations from a psychic, volunteers find the body of a murdered child and then call the police, realizing that only the murderer could know exactly where the victim's body lies. Would you believe they were innocent or suspects? A Venetian manuscript from the 14th century tells of a secret mission to American soil, 100 years before the continent is officially discovered. Did the last Knights Templar come to Canada to hide the Holy Grail? On November 16, 1999, a teenage girl of 16 gets off a bus a few steps from her home. She never reaches her destination. The question still lingers today. What happened to Julie Surprenant?
I'm Kenneth Welsh. Welcome to Northern Mysteries.
Thank you.
finding yourself in the middle of a fight is always unpleasant. And worse yet, when the quarrel is none of your business. Of course, the ideal stance is to calm both opponents down without taking sides. But what do you do when the belligerents are already dead?
In the early 1900s, on the shores of Lake Ontario, a prosperous local businessman decides to build himself a comfortable summer home. Around 1920, the property is sold to a rich immigrant who expands the original structure to accommodate his many servants. Just after the Second World War, the buildings undergo another transformation as they're split up into apartment units. Years later, in 1995, one of those apartments becomes the theater of a real-life drama, chapter one of an incredible ghost story. That year, a teenage girl of 15, sexually abused by her alcoholic mother's lovers, swallows a massive dose of prescription pills. She is not looking to end her life. Her actions are a cry for help and a little attention in her sad situation. Horribly, that night, her mother is too drunk to realize what her daughter has just done. The young woman dies, a prisoner of her sad situation. The following year, a family from Toronto, Al, Kelly, and their six-year-old daughter, Hailey, move into the apartment. The unsuspecting couple soon meet up with its invisible roommates.
Very shortly after we moved in, I always had the sense that something was following me, and I always heard footsteps behind me, no matter where I was in the house, whether it was on the stairs, in the kitchen, upstairs, wherever I was, I always heard footsteps.
Unable to find a rational explanation for these manifestations, Kelly's husband, Al, decides to consult a family friend, Richard Palmisano. Richard has been interested in strange and unexplained phenomena for several years. To investigate, Palmisano's first step is to hook up microphones and a tape recorder to capture otherworldly echoes in the house, also known as EVPs.
How EVP works is it's called electronic voice phenomena. And when an entity makes some type of communication or sounds, it's captured on tape at a low frequency, and the tape will boost it into a hearing range. We were finding in the house that this EVP was indicating there was some type of presence. The early tapes indicated there was a girl present in the house.
The recordings, as well as the constant opening and closing of the doors and windows, are soon followed by other manifestations. These provide clues to the identity of the invisible visitor.
During the investigation, Al decided that we should lay baby powder somewhere in the house. We laid a swath of baby powder from wall to wall, about a foot deep, and left the house. Upon our return, we found that there was a single footprint in that powder, and it was of a Doc Martin boot. And it was subsequently learned that the girl that had died in that house, well, those are her favorite shoes.
At first, Richard Palmisano had concluded that the family had been experiencing signs from the teenage girl who had died in the house the previous year. But then, the family experiences other apparitions beyond the murmurs and the footprints, including terrifying signs of a troubling dark presence. This ominous black shadow disrupting the household forces Richard to pay closer attention to Al and Kelly's accounts.
I would say the first time I recall seeing the black figure, I was upstairs vacuuming. And the vacuum turned off. And I saw a black figure going down, finishing down the end of the hallway and down the stairs. I didn't see arms or legs, but I definitely saw the shape of a head and shoulders, and it made noise as it was walking down the stairs. I did periodically hear voices here and there, but the shower always seemed to be when it was most prevalent. It seemed whenever I was vulnerable, it would really come around. A number of times, the water would be going hot and cold without me touching the taps. And the curtain did move quite often when I was in the shower. The one time the shower curtain moved, and I did feel a rather hard smack on the back of the head. So the bathroom was a definite source of it intimidating me.
I was waking up out of a sleep. I had glanced over, and it was beginning to get light out. And I glanced over, I thought it was Kelly. It wasn't Kelly at all. It was a short woman with dark hair, wearing a white towel, searching through her dresser.
Intrigued by these multiple apparitions, which are obviously not all caused by the teenage girl who died in 1995, Richard Palmisano decides to delve a little deeper into the past of the apartment buildings. He soon finds a string of disturbing incidents dating back to the dark days of the Second World War.
After England declared war, Canada as an independent member of the British Commonwealth of
Nations. In the early 1940s, the owner is arrested for his loyalty to Italian fascist dictator Benito Mussolini. His family then chooses to move to a more discreet home nearer to Toronto. At this point, the history of the Lakeside Manor takes a chilling turn. The manor is placed under the charge of a cruel and manipulative butler named Edward. His rule soon starts to resemble a dictatorship. For the staff of servants, mostly women, Edward's regime means rough treatment and constant humiliation. For the inhabitants of the manor, it feels like the walls are slowly closing in. Edward then meets up with a self-proclaimed doctor, wanted in the United States for performing illegal abortions. Together, the two men set up a clandestine clinic on the luxurious estate. Soon, Richard Palmisano starts to glimpse the truth behind the manifestations. This shadow, this oppressive entity, can be none other than Edward the Butler. The pattern of the apparition seems to point to the abominable butler trying beyond death to hide a terrible secret.
Kelly actually wanted to leave at that point, and Richard and I just carried out the investigation. We wanted to get down to the bottom of it.
For Richard, it is becoming more and more obvious that the dwelling had been the scene of some horrible crime. But what? Richard's research soon uncovers a terrible tragedy, going back to the darkest hours of World War II. In 1943, despite the curfew, a former servant arrives late at night on the steps of the manor. She is carrying all her savings. That night, in one of the estate's bedrooms, she is to undergo an abortion. But the procedure goes terribly wrong. Before the night is out, the 19-year-old woman is bleeding profusely. Then she stops breathing. In a panic, the doctor asks Edward to help him carry the body to the basement, where the girl can be buried in secret. The poor soul in the grave is still alive. Wrapped in a blood-drenched shroud, she's still twitching and moaning. Edward approaches, a large cement block in his hands. Her muffled cries of agony will take 65 years to be heard. A psychic advises Palmisano to pay closer attention to the manor's basement. Perhaps the key to the mystery is hidden there. This hypothesis is confirmed when strange murmuring sounds from the basement are captured on tape.
We were running audio tape in the basement. We set our recorders to record and we left the basement for a break to get some air. And it's during that time we came back to review the tapes. There was EVP. There were two portions on the tape. One was a female crying out, "Let me out, let me out." And then there was a second portion of a male, and he was saying, "Are we going to flip-flop?" And it was very disturbing, and it indicated there was something going on in that basement as well.
Al and Richard set out to excavate the basement, but the property's owner raises objections. Their only recourse is to turn to psychics to understand what truly happened on the site. One of the psychics finally relates to them the story of the body in the basement, one Angela Carlucci.
Angela Carlucci was a young servant girl. She was 19. When she died and she was placed in this basement to cover that crime, because she was Italian, we were at war. They simply said she went back to Italy. There was no questions. Virtually, it was a perfect crime. After the war, the family used the house for a short time, then they moved away. Edward died, and he came back to the house. And in death, he's still guarding his secrets.
Richard Palmisano's investigations have been explored in a published account entitled Overshadows. In the field, however, this investigation remains unfinished. Palmisano has opened but a crack in the door that leads to the troubled world of the supernatural. But the real door still lies sealed beneath 10 centimeters of concrete.
Since the Palmisano revelations, Al and his family have moved out. As for the ghosts of the aging manor, who knows? Maybe someday their souls will be set free from the suffering that still pursues them beyond the grave. Each year in Canada, more than 60,000 young children and teenagers disappear. Most of the time, these are cases of children running away from home or an abduction by one of the parents because of a conflict over custody. Fortunately, most of the time, these children are found and returned, safe and sound. Sometimes, however, these situations have tragic and unimaginable outcomes.
On November 1st, 1984, little Maurice Bien, aged 4, is kidnapped near his parents' house in Montreal. After bringing in the authorities, a large search operation is organized. This was the third in a strange series of disappearances. First, Wilton Lubin, aged 12, had disappeared. Then Sébastien Métivier, aged 8. Finally, young Maurice Vien. All three are apparent kidnappings reported on the same day in the same metropolitan area. Though there is no proof that these three disappearances are the work of a single kidnapper, the authorities do not rule anything out. They comb through all the nearby vacant lots. All empty buildings in the neighborhood are checked out. Posters go up from one end of the city to the other, but with no results. Then, 3 days later, A jacket belonging to Maurice Vien is found in St. Roch-sur-Richelieu, south of the St. Lawrence. The search area is expanded, and the Sûreté du Québec join the investigation. The next day, an off-duty policeman, Agent Stephen Lynch, personally and secretly interested in paranormal phenomena, and his acquaintance, Yvan Gagnon, a hypnotherapist from Beauport, set out, as the search expands, to hypnotize a businessman from Montreal's North Shore.
Wait, yes, I see the boys there. He's playing.
Is he alone?
No. He's standing beside a man.
The subject, that we will call simply Mr. X, is reputed to be a psychic, a person blessed with a gift for an extraordinary extrasensory perception.
Home now.
Where are they?
It's getting later. They're driving. It's starting to get dark.
The hypnotherapist's enthusiasm is easy to understand.
No.
Only 1 year before, Mr. X, in similar circumstances, provided valuable information regarding the murder of a six-year-old girl. Because of the success of his first experience with Mr. X, Yvan Gagnon hopes to once again harness the psychic's prowess. This time, the hypnotherapist concentrates on the circumstances surrounding little Maurice Vien's disappearance.
No. They seem to have left the highway. It's a pokey little back road, very twisty and narrow. They drive over train tracks. There's an old cabin. An abandoned shack falling down.
This cabin, where is it?
It's impossible to say. The man says, we're here. He gets out. He forces the kid to follow. It's dark. Very, very dark. He's dragging him. Oh, the bastard. He hits him. Then he rips his clothes off. It's horrible. Oh, my God. My God. He's got a rope. Oh, the bastard.
If we were to show you a map, would you be able to indicate the location of this cabin that you saw?
I think I would.
I was seeing things in Saint-Antoine-sur-Richelieu. Things that were unbelievably brutal. I could see the child's body. And I could see the house, too. It was terrible. It was horrifying to see. I never go to crime scenes myself, so I told them, go there and you'll see for yourselves. They called me and described the place where they were, and it was just like I saw in my vision.
Towards mid-afternoon on November 6th, the amateur sleuth's car starts down Monseigneur Gravel Road outside Saint-Antoine-sur-Richelieu. The location holds some promise. Soon, between the trees, the trio makes out a decrepit dwelling, much like the one Mr. X has described under hypnosis. The place is deserted. The windows boarded up. Yvan Gagnon walks in while his colleagues wait in the vehicle. The house is littered with floorboards and crumbling plaster. Then, through a hole in the floor, Yvan Gagnon sees the body of little Maurice Vien. The boy's body is lying face down and shows marks of violence. Within 20 minutes, the Sûreté du Québec patrol cars answer the alert and cut off the entire area.
Thank you.
But instead of thanking the men for their personal initiative, the officers take them in to be questioned at Sûreté du Québec headquarters in Montreal, where they are grilled on the details of their discovery.
Right. What's going on here?
Well, this will be somewhat difficult to believe, but the reason we've come is...
The provincial policeman from the Quebec City area found the body with the help of a hypnotist and a man claiming to be clairvoyant.
A few hours later, after hearing through the media that young Vien's body has been discovered, Mr. X contacts the authorities to explain his role in this strange affair.
The Quebec police force was trying to break me down. They sincerely believed that I was the main suspect in the murder. Because the details I gave my partners were so accurate, they figured I must be their man.
Despite their skepticism, the investigators soon come to realize that neither Mr. X nor Yvan Gagnon has anything to do with the kidnapping and the murder of little Maurice Vien. Without the involvement of Mr. X, in all likelihood, the police would have taken weeks to find the boy's body. Maurice Vien might have remained missing forever. The Maurice Vien affair was to have a considerable impact on everyone involved in this strange investigation. Yvan Gagnon eventually abandoned hypnotherapy. He now refuses to even talk about the Maurice Vien affair. As for Mr. X, he has long remained bitter over the attitude of the police in this matter.
In police investigations of disappearances, it's not unusual for psychics to offer assistance. Unfortunately, all too often, the information they provide proves to be too vague to be of any use to the officers involved. This is where the Maurice Vien case stands well apart from the others. It remains a rare occurrence in the annals of Canadian criminal investigation. Rumors of buried treasure, extraordinary mythic quests. This is a heady mix for occultists and mystery buffs. But it is a mix that may well force the experts to rewrite some of Canada's history.
In the latter part of the Middle Ages, when wars pitted Christian armies against the invading Muslims, the Crusades were the main concern of all the crowned heads of Europe. One fighting force stands above all the rest, the Order of the Knights Templar. Founded in 1118 to serve as protectors to guard the pilgrims' routes to the Holy Land, the order proved to be a profitable investment financially. William Mann, author of The Knights Templar in the New World, is an authority on the story of the Knights Templar.
The story about how the Templars obtained their riches during the First Crusades is a very interesting one. You have to appreciate that originally there were 9 poor knights, and outwardly their mission was to protect the roads, protect the pilgrims on the road to Jerusalem. But at the same time, they obviously had amazing power with the potentates and through the church. And the church allowed them to habitate the Temple of Solomon. And this is where they got their title, the Poor Knights of the Temple of Solomon. Below the temple, this is where the real activity occurred. They dug the stables of the Temple of Solomon. They dug through the stables, and supposedly they discovered immense riches. Perhaps the relics and treasure left over from the sacking of Jerusalem by the Romans. And furthermore, once their fame spread, you had a number of nobles across France rushing to join the order. And it was through these nobles that they forfeited all of their belongings upon initiation into the order. And this is where the Templars, over several hundred years, gained their immense wealth.
In 1291, the Holy Land falls under Muslim control. Thus end the Crusades. The Templars have no reason to exist anymore. Worse still, the King of France, Philippe the Fair, has his eyes on their fortune.
Philippe the Fair, he was obviously a snake. He was King of France, but he was broke, he was bankrupt, and he sanctioned the wealth of the Templars. And in this manner, he devised a plot where he accused the Templars of all kinds of evil doings, including heresy, homosexuality, spitting on the cross, denouncing Christ. And it was through these charges that he was able to generate a war against the Templars themselves.
In March of 1314, Jacques de Molay, the order's last Grand Master, is burned at the stake in Paris as a heretic. But no one finds any trace of the riches coveted by Philippe the Fair. Of course, the monarchy has seized the order's vast domains, but the Templars' fabulous treasure and all their precious objects remain hidden from Philippe's grasp. It seems that the king has been fooled.
Luckily, the Templars were tipped off. On Friday, October the 13th, 1314, the Templars sculled away the night before the sacking was to occur. And with them, they took 18 wagon loads of supposed Templar treasure. And it's this mystery that intrigues all of us.
This is where history slips into the realm of legend. An obscure album containing correspondence and maps turns up in Venice in 1558. Its author, one Niccolò Zeno, a man named after his more renowned predecessor, claims the documents are true reproductions of the correspondence between two of his ancestors who both died more than 150 years before, the brothers Antonio and Niccolò Zeno. For Paul Falardeau, author of Société Secrète en Nouvelle-France, Secret Societies in New France, the Zeno brothers' maps constitute the genesis for an incredible adventure.
The Zeno brothers' maps had been in the family for at least a century and a half. What was special about these maps was the fact that they illustrated practically the entire Northern Hemisphere, from England all the way across the ocean to Nova Scotia in America. On the map, we can clearly see Iceland, Greenland, and the Labrador coastline, as well as Nova Scotia, which went by the name of Estody Land.
As for the letters, they describe an incredible expedition undertaken by the Zeno brothers. Venetian navigators who in 1397, almost a century before Columbus discovered America, traveled with a Scottish nobleman, Prince Henry Sinclair, to this land they called Estota Land. Setting sail from Scotland's Orkney Islands, the Sinclair expedition claims to have sighted the Labrador coast, then Newfoundland, before landing in Nova Scotia. Henry Sinclair brought his own company of several hundred men, the heirs of the Knights Templar.
Prince Henry Sinclair accepted the challenge of guiding 13 galleys containing the Templar treasure from the Orkneys to Nova Scotia. Within those galleys, we find 500 Knights Templars, some of their wives and children, but we also find Cistercian monks who were necessary if you were looking to establish an agricultural settlement, because they were the most advanced in the world at the time in agricultural practices.
Is it truly possible that 85 years after the death of Jacques de Molay, the last members of the Order of the Temple landed in Nova Scotia? What were they looking for? And who was this mysterious Henry Sinclair? Rory Sinclair belongs to the Canadian branch of the Sinclair lineage.
We are so pleased to have in our family a man of such stature that we can put together at this distance in time. But it's clear he was a man of extraordinary ability who was intrepid, who was smart, who was brave, and who arrived in North America not to conquer anybody, but to say, you show me what you know, and I'll show you what I know, and let's go forward as brothers.
Besides exploration, the Sinclair mission has a mystic component. Several authors are convinced that the voyagers brought with them a relic of inestimable value. Could this have been the Holy Grail? The Ark of the Covenant? The treasures of Constantinople? Or a secret object even more threatening to the power of the Roman Church?
People always ask me, what's the treasure of Prince Henry Sinclair? What is the Templar treasure? And the answer that I give them is a stock one. If they want to believe in treasure, yes, there was physical treasure there. The Grail is a multi-leveled treasure. On one hand, it could be the Cup of Christ. On the other hand, it could be the remnants from the sacking of Jerusalem by Rome in 70 AD. On the other hand, it could be the results of the sacking and pillaging by the Knights Templar in the First Crusades. It also could be in part the genealogical records of the marriage between Jesus Christ and Mary Magdalene, and the genealogical record recording all of their descendants.
Whatever the relic, the Templars are determined to keep it out of the hands of the infidels. The Templars wish to bury it in a place where only they and their initiates could find it. They chose a small island in Mahone Bay off Nova Scotia named Oak Island. Putting their remarkable engineering skills to use, the Templars were entirely capable of burying the precious relic at the bottom of a vast man-made vault. This vault is known today as the Money Pit. Discovered at the end of the 18th century by three teenagers who were exploring Oak Island, the Money Pit looks like a very deep well of 5 meters in diameter.
The physical description of the Money Pit is, in essence, is a hydraulic trap. If you picture a big vase with a cork, or a big beaker with a cork stuck in the top, in essence, Oak Island was developed along the same principles. It had a series of water traps which were airtight, and those water traps ran to the coves surrounding Oak Island. But the main feature was the Money Pit itself. And the Money Pit had a series of logs tiered at every 10 feet with putty and coconut fiber. And that, in essence, created the vacuum.
When the pit was finally opened, an incredible system of flooded tunnels that was designed to bring seawater inside the well then provoked the flooding of the main shaft. Since then, every attempt to dry up the pit and reach its bottom has been fruitless. Apart from their adventure on Oak Island, the voyagers apparently left behind many vestiges that bear witness to their early visit to the New World.
This is the ancient cannon, which was dredged out of Louisburg Harbor here. It proves without a shadow of doubt that Prince Henry Sinclair came here with his Venetian captain. These were the cannon Carlo Zen used. It proves the Zeno narrative is true. It changes the history of the discovery of the New World. A Venetian captain came here with a Scottish prince and his expedition 100 years before Columbus reached the West Indies.
There is other evidence that has been recently found. In Westford, just outside of Boston, there is an effigy carved on a rock. And it's an effigy of Sir James Gunn, who was in actual fact the right-hand man of Prince Henry Sinclair.
Legend has it that Prince Henry Sinclair and his crew rubbed shoulders with Mi'kmaq Indian tribes
and inspired part of their legends.
A century before Christopher Columbus discovered America, could Prince Henry Sinclair and the surviving adherents of the Order of the Temple land on Nova Scotia's shores? Does the legendary Templar's treasure lie buried on Mahone Bay's tiny Oak Island? Could the Holy Grail be hidden on Canadian soil? At first glance, this legend seems impossible. Or does it? Confronted by the incomprehensible and enigmatic nature of a disappearance, those affected constantly wonder, what happened? Where is our loved one? Is he or she still alive? These are questions that the family of a missing teenager from Terrebonne on the north shore of Montreal have been asking themselves for years.
Tuesday, November 16th, 1999, around 8:30 p.m., Julie Surprenant, a 16-year-old teenager, leaves the youth center on Hauteville Boulevard in Terrebonne. The center is a spot where many young people in the region congregate. Accompanied by a friend, Julie gets on a bus at the intersection of Hauteville Boulevard and Côté Boissé Street. Two teenagers chat during the whole trip. Julie shows no signs of nervousness. Quite the opposite. She's in good spirits and seems totally at ease. At 8:50 p.m., the young woman, alone, gets off the bus at the Galerie de Terrebonne on Maudit Boulevard. There, as usual, she transfers to bus 25A for Montreal. It is her usual route to her home on Castile Street. The adolescent then gets off at her stop near Autoroute 25. The bus stop is situated a few hundred meters from her home, but Julie will never make it home.
On the night of Julie Surprenant's disappearance, what we know is that she took the bus and she stopped near Autoroute 25 in Terrebonne. This is the last time that Julie was seen alive.
When he realizes his daughter is not showing up, Michel Surprenant quickly understands that something serious has happened. Once alerted, the Terrebonne police detectives go through the usual fact gathering. Quickly, they eliminate the possibility that Julie may have run away. The local police call in the Sûreté du Québec for what is looking more and more like a criminal affair.
Julie was a happy, free-spirited child, well-liked by all of her friends. If she had left intentionally, she would have contacted somebody, whether it be me, her mother, or one of her friends. She definitely would have called someone if she had simply run away.
It was a pretty sad case, because here was a young teenage girl and by all accounts, was a well-liked girl amongst her friends. The father was a bit strict, and she seemed to be okay with this. It wasn't a runaway because she was rebelling against a strict father or something like that. And so it was one of those things that it was really strange at how this girl who didn't seem to have been in any trouble before, didn't seem to have any relationships that would cause her to run away, suddenly disappeared.
The Julie Surprenant affair quickly makes headlines. The disappearance of this quiet teenager has people talking all over the city. Scores of photos are published in the media, while search parties of a magnitude never before seen in Quebec are organized, but without results.
The night that Julie got off this bus, the first people to see her leave were the people on the bus. So you have the bus driver who was met with, you have 8 out of 13 people that were in that bus that have called the Sûreté du Québec to give us information on her whereabouts, where she was heading, and things like that.
The Sûreté du Québec soon broadcast an appeal to the public at large. It seems that 2 men have been seen near the bus shelter at the time Julie disappeared.
What we have found out with all the testimonies that of all these people on the bus is that they might have been 2 people, one waiting at the bus stop and another man a bit further down the road. So we had an artist sketch the details of these people that were, they were telling us, a 20-year-old man wearing this kind of clothing. At that time, we had sent publicly the 2 sketches of these people, but they were not suspect at that time. They were witnesses.
Witnesses show up right and left. One driver, for example, reports having seen Julie several hours after her disappearance. According to his testimony, the day following the incident, he twice came upon a white van whose driver was maneuvering suspiciously. Once on the Terrebonne Bridge, and a second time, a few minutes later, next to an abandoned lot. Here, he said he could see the passengers of the vehicle, 2 men and a teenage girl. Was this young woman Julie Surprenant? In situations like this one, there is a thin line between what people actually saw and what they believe they saw.
Since the day of Julie Surprenant's disappearance, we've had so many calls from the public. We've treated over 1,500 calls. We have verified all the information that people were giving us, either on possible suspects. Some of them were real witnesses. Some of them were people who thought that they had seen Julie Surprenant in the days following her disappearance. We had deployed so many people of the Sûreté du Québec and also of the Terrebonne Police Department to search the area. We had sent out the helicopter, the dogs of the Sûreté du Québec. We also had the people of the public help us in our searches in the woods of the area. Unfortunately, all the information, all the 1,500 informations that we got were unsuccessful, because to this day, the only thing that we are sure of is that at 9 o'clock, Julie Surprenant got off the bus. And after that, it's unknown where she is.
In March of 2000, police proceed to arrest a neighbor suspected in several sexual attacks. Even if he cannot be formally tied to the disappearance of the teenager, the media immediately asks the question, is this man Julie Surprenant's attacker?
At that time, the media had mentioned Julie Surprenant's neighbor. This is an ongoing investigation, even though it's been 5 years, so we can't go into the details of every bits and parts of this investigation.
Today, years after Julie's disappearance, the authorities have still not given up.
The disappearance of Julie Surprenant, the case is still ongoing, it's still open. The investigators have this case at heart. They have her picture on their desks, and every day they look at her. We want to solve this disappearance.
For Michel Surprenant, the disappearance of his daughter remains an enigma. Even if time has prepared him for the worst, he still holds on to the hope that one day he will discover what happened to Julie.
For a long time, I didn't want to face my grief. I was angry at myself, and I would think, what if she suddenly comes back? How will it look if I'm acting as if she were dead? But someone told me, no, go ahead and deal with your grief, and if she does come back, don't worry, you'll patch things up. We have to face our grief, otherwise life is unbearable. We never fully heal, we just learn to live with the pain. We need to find a balance in our lives. There's no other choice. I have another daughter and she needs me. She has to go on living as well, she has to keep moving forward on her own path. And she has to find her own balance.
The disappearance of Julie Surprenant was one of Quebec's most widely covered news events in recent memory. Authorities received more than 1,500 calls from the public. Unfortunately, to this day, Not one single clue has been found that might shed any light on this most mysterious affair.
Fantastic encounters, enigmatic disappearances, strange truths, and fabulous legends. Maybe someone can finally reveal the truth behind these extraordinary mysteries. And maybe that someone is you.